everybody, we're back with Sidebar, and we're talking about hanging on to hope during the holidays. And I'm here with Brian and with Danny again, and thanks so much for being here. We want to talk a little bit about emotions, the emotions of a season like the holidays, Thanksgiving, Christmas, and all of that. And the reality is it's probably a season for a lot of people where the highs are even higher, and then for others, the lows are even lower. Struggles with depression, anxiety, loneliness skyrocket during the holidays. And we want to be able to say a few things like, remember, you're not alone, but also like, you're not living a Hallmark movie or a Lifetime, whichever one you choose. There's probably not going to be a bow on Alexis at the end of your story. And every dilemma is not going to be resolved by the ending credits scene. And that's still okay. And it's okay to experience high highs and low lows. For some, you're entering a season that's one of the most traumatic seasons of loss. I mean, we're still coming out of, or in, depending on your perspective, a global pandemic. For others, you're good. Like, you're like, this is a good season, except you're close to others who are hurting. And how do you learn sort of the balance, the both end of what the Apostle Paul talks about in Romans 12? Rejoice with those who rejoice, mourn with those who mourn. There's so much to rejoice about in a season like this. Yeah. There's you got a baby, like a brand new baby. We rejoice with that kind of thing. But then there's also so much to mourn. And tears and laughter are not like, they're not pushing each other apart. They're drawing each other together. They're mutually exclusive. It's both. And depending on the moment, the situation, the person we're talking to, sometimes tears and laughter are appropriate. Sometimes the laughter is right after the tears and vice versa. So we're going to talk about emotions a little bit. What kind of thoughts, as we sort of broach the topic of emotions and hanging on to hope, what kind of thoughts do you two have as we talk about this subject?
Well, let me just say, especially for the guys, I feel like this is a topic maybe they've already thought about checking out of this.
Fast forward.
Yeah. Let me just say, guys, stay tuned for a moment. Don't check out of this podcast yet, because I think there's some really important things. But I want to say this at the outset of our conversation, that our emotions are intrinsically tied to our, again, that imago Dei, the design that God has put in us. He has made us emotional beings bearing his image. He is an emotional God. He has created beauty. He has created the weather patterns that create fog that create a different emotion versus sunshine and waves that are crashing on a sunshiny day. A foggy day at the beach feels really different than a beautiful, sunny, warm day at the beach. And like, we feel that, like, we are emotional. Guys, you have emotions.
And
we
there's
have,
beauty in variety.
There's beauty in all. And that is part of the life experience, the human experience that God has created, that we live in and exist in. So to be in touch with our emotions, to begin to learn about them and to embrace them fully. We have tear ducts designed by God for a reason. You don't need to be sorry about them. Now, some of us need to understand that we don't always have to go to our tear ducts as our MO, but there is a time to grieve. There is a time to find that the salt water that comes out of those eyes is actually a good thing for your whole being, for your soul. This might be one of those seasons for some. Pete Scazzaro has this great quote about emotions. Ignoring our emotions is turning our back on reality. Listening to our emotions ushers us into reality. And reality is where we meet God. Emotions are the language of the soul. They are the cry that gives the heart a voice. So to be out of touch with our emotions is to be out of touch literally with God. So I think this conversation is really important. And I hope, especially for some of our guys, maybe there'll be a few helpful tools and tips out of this conversation.
Yeah. That's good.
Yeah. As someone who has been labeled as emotional, I fully relate. I think of the day that I walked into our good friend, Ron Nottingham, walked into his office just crying. And I think the best advice he gave was, don't think you're weak because you're crying. Right. I just want you to understand why. Yeah. Mm. And that was when he first pointed me to counseling and therapy. And I was like, yeah, that is, like, I'm allowed to cry and I'm allowed to feel emotions, but why? Yeah. I need to figure out the why. And so I can get tools to run through that. And I was talking to our good friend Shelley Majors here, who's really good about counseling and whatnot. And she pointed out to me that the holiday season mostly affects people that are already dealing with depression, anxiety, whatnot, any mental illness.
It doesn't create them, it exposes
them. Yes, it just takes that knob and just turns it on high. So if we're gonna kick this off first, if you're already experiencing those, you can come to us for help. We can point you in the direction of counseling and therapy. Because if you're already experiencing it, it's gonna be turned on to high. Right. So
stuffing them, stuffing your emotions, avoiding your emotions is not going to help. Mm-hmm. Thinking you'll get to it after the holidays pass, mm-hmm. when you actually have some time, is probably not going to be a good thing. And again, it's as we're talking about in this series, there are actually some decisions we can make now, today, that could help us hang on to hope through these holidays in a different way, in a unique way. And we just want to encourage people to take an action step, to be proactive and not just passively go through a season and hope it gets better.
Yeah. You know, Aaron, we've been walking quite a bit of life together over a decade now, just wild to think about. And in that time we've been walking together, there's been many a Christmas season. One Christmas season where you put a picture of a pack of dogs on your dog and brought it to our house to let us know that, to let my wife know that she's getting a dog.
And the first child.
Yeah, the first child, the first fluffy one. But also some Christmases that were grim and dark and really, 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 really hard. And we've walked some of those pieces together connected to your story. And give us a little, just for folks in case they're watching this, don't know a little bit about your story, maybe give us the highlight reel. But as you do that, I think back to seasons where things were dark for you and for Holly and for your kids. And I always wonder how could we have met you guys differently in the midst of crisis, in a way that would have been helpful and thoughtful, and that would have been more emotionally intelligent. Right. You know, I think this is a season where people are gonna have folks walking into their situation in their home, where crisis is real.
Yeah.
Loss is real. And so I'd love for you to
speak to that. Well, this is going to be for many a COVID Christmas again, like a crisis Christmas, a crisis holiday season again. Because of our story with our daughter, the level of crisis doesn't feel that intense because of past experiences, but that doesn't mean it's not intense for others. But 2009, our daughter's diagnosed with a just incredibly aggressive form of brain cancer, immediately taken to brain surgery, just this intensive chemotherapy that you can't even imagine. So as October approached, November approached of that year, you could see ahead, the holidays are coming, and you could anticipate, we're going to be in the hospital. So crisis lingered into the Christmas season, knowing we're going to be in the hospital and to some degree secluded and all alone. We have two other kids and life, you know, for them, they can't be in the hospital for Christmas. So like now we're separated from our family and like we're just anticipating this is going to be all kinds of bad. And it was. I mean, honestly, you know, there were the early days of being able to even, I don't know what we did, FaceTime, I don't know what it was, but we could do a little bit of interaction, but it's not the same as being together. And so we were sort of having to prepare our hearts. This is going to be the families in two different places, mom or dad with two kids at home and one of us in a hospital. And in the midst of that, this crazy idea for Kate's Crazy Cool Christmas was born. Partly a brilliant idea, partly we were out of our minds, but it gave a sense of some joy and help in that season. But a couple of things we learned was the importance of showing up, not having answers, but just meeting others in their pain, mourning with others when they mourn. And we were talking earlier about we didn't need answers. Nobody could answer, but showing up was important. But we did need acknowledgement, and acknowledgement was one of the things we learned was we were the ones suffering. So maybe let us set the course of the conversation. Don't try to force a conversation on us. And there's lots of times we want to talk about it. We wanted the acknowledgement of this is bad. We wanted the acknowledgement of we're so sorry, your daughter's sick. Not the avoidance of, hey, how are you doing? How's the weather? What are you getting for Christmas? It's like, no, this isn't normal. And so finding that balance is usually letting the other person guide you. And so I know what it's like to be the person who's in the emotional state, to be the family that's in the emotional state of crisis. But I also know what it's like to try to come alongside of others with empathy, with compassion, and to meet them and to be there in such a way that like provides support and figuring out that balance. Like Kate's Crazy Cool Christmas brought a ton of joy to a whole hospital and our family. Mm. And cancer brought a whole host of mourning into our holiday season. And we tried to learn to do both at that same time. And that's what I would really encourage a lot of people in this season. If you're trying to hang on to hope, you actually can have joy and you actually can have mourning at the same time. But to fight for both, it's not easy. But there is a pathway forward to balance both of those.
So for people who, because joy and pain, yeah, also a song, that's a throwback. But for people who are walking in the pain and walking into their family gatherings, right, with the pain, right, I mean, you have, or with the crisis, how would you encourage them? Because suddenly, and I think some of why we don't, as family, friends, acknowledge the pain is because we know it's going to be the fundamental shift that's going to kind of, sure, put the fog back in the room. Mm-hmm. And suddenly the joy and the sparkle of the Hallmark holiday that we were hoping for is going to be shrouded by the death of the loved one, the cancer journey that somebody's facing. Yep. And like, how would you encourage a person who's walking through the pain not to ignore it, yes, to acknowledge it in those seasons, but not to also let it be the thing that drives the 6 hours of the family gathering isn't, exactly, completely shrouded by that?
Well, I mean, obviously I think there's a part of this that it depends. It depends on the level of the pain. Mm. It depends on where is the crisis at.
Good.
If it's fresh and it's raw, like there's probably not a lot you can do.
Yeah.
But just endure the next season. And to try to come up with a quick fix or a solve in the critical moments of crisis, it's like, it would just be for us, like in the hospital with the daughter, chemo being pumped through her veins, to try to say, let's just get over this and try to get on with life. It's like, that's impossible. For somebody to come in and say, cheer up, God's in control, Merry Christmas, like, there's a timeliness to truth. And that's not the right time for that kind of truth. That's the kind of time for, I'm so sorry, we're with you in this. How can we help? But then there's other kinds of pain. There's other kinds of emotional where it's not at crisis level,
yeah,
but it's challenging and it's difficult. And you still, like, it's not enough to say, hey, I'm struggling with a little bit of stress. I'm probably just going to bounce on all the holidays. It's like, no, you actually probably need people.
Good.
Yeah. But how do you need people in appropriate and healthy ways? And it's okay to have boundaries, mm-hmm, like set up healthy boundaries. It's easy to do when you're in a hospital because it's like, nope, nobody. It's harder to do when you're like, this wound is internal and I'm walking into a meal with family and they can't see it, although I feel it. There's some boundaries that have to be established. You know, we talk about counseling so much around here, but like, there's work to be done, whatever today is, before you get to that next holiday event or meal. Like, schedule an appointment with a counselor. If you can't schedule an appointment with a counselor, is there a friend? Is there an older, wiser, healthier person in this season that you could just say, I just need to be refreshed for a moment because I know there's a taxing season coming. Mm. Are there some things that you could do to move forward in health because you know there's an expenditure, there's stress coming, so you're preparing to get there. You know, I learned this about myself, not in crisis, but in like normal stress. Mm-hmm. In normal stress, we would fly to Iowa to be with family. And again, I've mentioned I'm an introvert, but like for the last 13 years or so, we've been in crisis. You never fully get out of that. And so, There's these things in the holiday season that I learned about myself that I would just say they're important always. Now, in the critical moment of crisis, you probably can't do it. But in the non-critical moments of crisis, I just would say keep some similar rhythms. In the holiday season, so much is disturbed. Our rhythm is disturbed. Our time is disturbed. Our energy, our eating habits. So like there's things like eat well, exercise, sleep are all turned upside down, that the little movement for me to say, no, I'm going to take time to exercise today, even though I'm with this family and it's completely different, I'm going to withdraw and retreat, okay, and refresh so that I can go and re-engage. I love to read. I love a good podcast. And sometimes I'm like, I just need to call a timeout and I need to go and do this for the sake of my emotional mental state so that I can then re-engage at a level that is honoring to the people that I'm with. The worst thing in those moments for me and for some of us would be, I'm just going to withdraw and retreat for good and cut off all relationships, because it's like, no, in this season, relationships in the right measure may be the exact thing we need. And so retreating is not going to be best in the long run, but boundaries and a healthy approach are the way forward.
Yeah. And I think it's okay to put boundaries and time caps even on like a specific event, because I think back to when I first started like realizing I was struggling with depression in high school and college. I remember leaving a family event. It wasn't holidays, but it was a family event, and I just cried to my mom and I was like, I just feel like I used all my happy chemicals.
Huh, yeah.
Like I used as many coins as I could that were happy just to put on the smile, to be happy. And then I just feel so spent.
Now you feel bankrupt.
Yeah.
Yes.
And it's recognizing that even a single event has a time cap of like, oh, I'm hitting the wall. And if I leave this event an hour later, I'm going to be in my bed feeling even worse than I would have if I left an hour earlier. And I'm still relaxed and I still have that energy to go into the next day and have quiet time, podcasts you mentioned, exercise, still having enough to spend in that so that I can recharge, I think was the best.
That's such a great analogy when we think about our emotional state, our time, our energy, like we would our finances. Mm-hmm. Yeah. How do you budget your time, your energy? How do you have a savings in order to then spend but not go in debt that then you are in regret for days and days and days to recover? It's like, no, healthy limits, healthy budget of energy, emotions, just like we do our finances, and making those decisions ahead of time really sets us up for a season that, I'm not saying it's going to be easy. I'm not saying it's like this complete, like it was a complete transformation. It went from terrible to terrific. Well, no, that's not the goal, to go from terrible to terrific. The goal is progress. The goal is hold on to hope and don't let go of that in this season.
I really feel too, if you've never taken steps towards finding a rhythm and you know you're walking into this holiday season and hope, you want that to be the marking of your story, but you know that hopelessness feels like it's marking it even greater. Take the courageous step and start doing some of the disciplines that you guys are talking about. I mean, first and foremost, are you inviting Jesus into some of those emotional struggles and pains, inviting him in, but then past inviting him in is the courageous steps of obedience to pick up the phone, to let a pastor or a spiritual leader in your life in on, hey, I'm really dealing with depression, anxiety, even suicidal thoughts. And I want somebody to know, you need to tell somebody. And then thirdly, and maybe even more important than telling your pastor is to make that courageous call to a licensed therapist. And we recommend a great Christian therapist, if you can prioritize that, but to actually do the courageous thing that we're still trying to end the stigma on good Christian therapy, but like, you gotta make, some of us need to make the call in this season, even before we get to the gather, have your first time with a therapist that can help you start working through, how am I supposed to navigate going into this with all that I'm facing, with all that my emotions are bringing up in me right now, and the anxiety now that the family gathering is putting on me because of all the emotional stuff that's underneath the skin here. How do I walk into this? And to get some tools in your toolbox that you can take into this holiday season with you, but don't go at it alone. Yeah. Do the courageous thing. And for most of us, the most courageous thing is to pick up the phone or to search on the internet to find out who we're supposed to call.
I totally agree. And I just feel like this is an invitation. Peter, in his epistle, 1 Peter speaks of this in chapter 5, verse 7, cast all your anxiety on him, on Jesus, because he cares for you. And that's not a one-time event. That's a daily ongoing. You're placing your burdens, you're placing your anxieties on him. And a counselor is a great way to do it, but you're probably not meeting with a counselor every day.
Totally.
Every day is, what about praying? And sometimes we don't think about this. Pray for your emotions. Pray specifically, pray your emotions. Sometimes cry out your prayers, shout out your prayers is a way forward. This season for some is known to be the Advent season, a season of waiting. And we know waiting can be hard, but there's resources for our journey. Bible Project, you can just Google Bible Project Advent. There's a great video resource just to help guide the journey through this season. We've used this book around here. Oh, sorry. Louis Giglio has a book called Waiting Here for You. That's an Advent journey that helps you pray along that. But I think those little practices, those little decisions today, I'm going to pray.
Yeah.
Today, I'm going to cast my anxieties on God. Today, I'm going to prepare because I know something's coming where I'll need that. And doing those small things can make a big difference in this season.
I feel like there's a practical prayer. Maybe we can just kind of wrap with this. What if you ask God and then you just sort of listen for the still small voice? What are three words coming into this season that could be my repetitive prayer? Because sometimes I need the repetition of a prayer or a few thoughts or ideas that could be the anchor point for you. So it could be your kingdom, your love, your heart. For those that dealing with anxiety, your peace, your hope, your joy. And you just say that over and over and over when it's bubbling up, whether you're alone or you're with the people that you're with, God, your peace, your hope, your love. But could you find three words that become your repetitive prayer in this season that you just use as your go-to and invite Jesus into all of it? And we'll be praying with you and all of us as we take in our emotional selves, which are a beautiful part of God's design in us into this holiday season.
Love that.
Great.
Love that.